Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you again for the privilege of studying your word. As we learned, our last Sunday when Kevin was teaching how many hundreds of thousands or millions of people across the world can do what we're doing tonight without fear of somebody persecuting them, even to death. So we thank you that in a free country, which is founded upon Christian principles, it only works because of the freedom that you gave us in Jesus Christ, that we can sit here and study your word. I thank you for these men, for their taking the time to be here, and that you work in all of us to learn things from your word that you would have us learn that are going to most benefit us in our everyday Christian lives. And we thank you for these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, my name is Steve Kyle. I'm an elder here at church. We're going to be looking at Joshua chapter 12. We're going to do a little bit of an overview first, because we've been studying Joshua for 3 months probably. So, brief overview, not a big deal, but I encourage you, of course, to read the book of Joshua. It's 24 chapters long. I'm guessing it would take you about, if you're a quote-unquote average reader, maybe hour, possibly 2 hours to read, just sit down, start to finish. It's really not that long. So I encourage you to read it so you begin to get a scope. The best Bible study, who's heard me say this before, the best Bible study is Bible reading. Read the Bible in a good translation, not paraphrase, translation. Okay? Just read God's Word. The more scope you build of God's Word, the more satisfying your individual study of God's Word is going to be, because the more you fit things together, and the more the Holy Spirit can work in you to fit things together. I mean, there is a study part of studying the Bible. There's also a Holy Spirit working in you part of the Bible. So, but the more scope you have, the more He can bring things to your remembrance that He might not otherwise. So I encourage you to read God's Word. Okay, so it covers time from the death of Moses to Joshua's death. I think a number of these things I have repeated. If you've ever had children or witnessed the growth of children, you'll possibly notice that you need to repeat things a lot. Sit up, lean over your plate. Sit up, lean over your plate. Sit up, lean over your plate. Okay, so about 5 million times you do that. So as Christian believers, many times to learn things from God's Word, we need to repeat. Period of time is about 17 years. We'll learn a little later. That's from start to finish. That's from when they Acts for Joshua chapter 1 through 24. In Joshua chapter 1, just to give you an idea, Joshua's in his early 90s. Okay? That's when he's embarking on taking the promised land, fulfilling what God set for him to do. When it ends, he's 110. In Joshua chapter 24, at the end of it, he dies. He's 110 years old. Okay? So he's in his early 90s. By the time he finishes doing what God asked him to do, going into the promised land and taking that land, leading the children of Israel that way, it was about a 7-year period of fighting. So in Joshua chapter 12, we're going to read essentially about the synopsis of what they did. There's not a lot in there other than this is whom they conquered, right? But that took roughly 7 years, and you've got to remember that at the time of Joshua chapter 12, when the conquest part of things was done, he's 100 years old. So keep that in mind. There's a lesson in itself to be learned from that, in that we can't afford to get stale because of age. Right? He was early 90s when he starts. He was 100 when he finished the conquest part, and 110 before the end of the book. So, about 17 years long, the book itself. 7 years for the conquest. For the sections, chapters 1 through 12, we're reading kind of the end of the first section, is the actual conquest of the promised land. Chapters 13 through 22, he's dividing up the land to the children of Israel. The tribe of Gad gets this, the tribe of Reuben gets this, the tribe of Judah gets this. That's 13 through really 21, 45, and 22 some, because in 22, you may remember from reading chapter 1, he talks about the east side of the Jordan was given to the tribe of Reuben, the tribe of Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. Okay, so he kind of reviews that in chapter 22. And then 23 and 24 are kind of Joshua's, it's kind of an epilogue, it's closing remarks. I mean, he is going to be dying. He's going to go the way of all flesh. So chapter 23 and 24 is what he's finally saying to the children of Israel, his parting remarks. Huge amounts to be learned from that, but we'll cover that at a time. Just amazing things that he said in light of what it says about the state of the children of Israel at that time, after everything they had done. Okay, so, and then chapters 23 and 24 are listed, Joshua's closing remarks. The chapter specifically, chapter 1, you know, Moses, my servant, is dead. Okay? Arise and go. This is what you got to do. Moses is gone. Remember, this is the guy that led the children of Israel with the 10 plagues in Egypt, with parting the Red Sea, with manna every day in the wilderness, etc., etc., etc. And now he's gone. Put yourself in Joshua's shoes. How are you going to fill those shoes? Right? But what God says to him in that chapter is, Moses, my servant, is dead. Arise, go. Now he doesn't give him time to wait. He isn't going to cry in his fear here. He's going to, pardon the analogy, he's going to go. He's got to go to capture that promised land. Chapter 2, Rahab and the two spies. Chapters 3 and 4, crossing the Jordan and Jericho. Remember, there's 1.5 million people here we're talking about. Remember, there was a 16-foot section of the River Jordan, based on what the text says, from Adam down to Gilgal, right in that area. That was not, no water there. Just stopped the flow and they all crossed at that time. That's that chapter. Then chapter 5, the recircumcision of all the men, okay? Thousands of men. Manna finally stops in chapter 5 and they start to actually eat food from the promised land. But manna doesn't stop falling daily, 6 days a week, on 7, until then. Okay? And then the appearing of the captain of the Lord's army at the end of that chapter to Joshua. 6 is the conquest of Jericho. Chapter 7, Ai and Achan's sin, when he keeps some of what he shouldn't have. And chapter 8 is the taking of Ai. Chapter 9, Tom walked us through the Gibeon ambassadors kind of working wildly to make a lead. Remember that God's original command to the children of Israel was, you kill everybody. Well, Gibeon knew that, so they said, okay, we'll go a different way here. We'll try to disguise ourselves and say, okay, we'll make peace with you. And that's what that chapter is about. Chapter 10, the conquest of all those places. Machida, Libna, Lachish, Gezer, Eglon, Hebron, Debir, Kadesh Barnea, Gaza, Goshen, Gibeon. And chapter 11, conquest of Hazor, Madon, Shimron, Akshaf, and others that are mentioned in the chapter. We'll see in chapter 12, there are 31 on the west side of Jordan that are conquered. Now, let's look at a map. Okay, so now we're going to just read, I think. And we're going to read chapter 12. So, if you would, get your Bibles or phones or whatever it is you're using and go to Joshua chapter 12. I'm going to read, not because I don't want you to read, but because there's a whole lot of Bible words in here that are. So if I pronounce them wrongly, that's great. It doesn't really matter. So, chapter 12 of Joshua. Now these are the kings of the land, which the children of Israel smote and possessed their land on the other side of Jordan toward the rising of the sun, from the river Arnon unto Mount Hermon, and all the plain on the east. Now, I want to show you that first. I think it's worth it. So, the first things they're talking about is the river Arnon. Okay, so the east side of the river is, it says, toward the rising of the sun, right? So here's the Dead Sea. Here's the Sea of Galilee. This is the focus most of the time. You know, Nazareth is there, so this is the focus most of the time of Jesus Christ's ministry. When you read in the Gospels, that's the Sea of Galilee. In the Old Testament, it's sometimes called the Sea of Kinnereth. Okay, so that's this little body of water here. That's the River Jordan, between the Sea of Galilee and the Dead Sea. So the side of Jordan toward the sea, toward the rising of the sun, is this side. And what they're talking about is this whole area here. That's what that chapter just talked about. Mount Hermon is up by Damascus. And the river they talk about, Arnon, is right now about just the southern edge of the Dead Sea. So this whole plain is what they're talking about. Okay? So, just so you know, geographically. The scripture, when it speaks geographically, speaks accurately. And it behooves us to generally know what we're talking about. We'd say the same thing in the United States. I mean, if you were describing it here, you'd do the same thing. Okay. So, let's keep reading. Sihon, king of the Amorites, who dwelt in Heshbon, and ruled from Aroer, which is upon the bank of the river Arnon, and from the middle of the river, in Joshua chapter 12. And from half Gilead, even unto the river Jabbok, which is the border of the children of Ammon. And from the plain to the sea of Chinneroth on the east, and unto the sea of the plain, even the salt sea on the east, the way to Beth Jeshimoth, and from the south under Ashdod Pisgah. And the coast of Og, okay, so let's take just that part.
Okay, so the area they're talking about there, just so you understand geographically what's going on, is right there. Okay? Whoops, I'm sorry. I got it backwards. It's right there. They describe the southern area first. This is Sihon, and then we're going to read about Og. So these were two kings that they conquered, actually, while Moses was still alive. Because this area is the area they gave to the tribe of Reuben, Gad, and half-tribe of Manasseh, this side of Jordan. So those guys were defeated while Moses was still alive. Okay? So that's what we're reading about there. Let's go on. Verse 4. And the coast of Og, king of Bashan, which was of the remnant of the giants that dwelt at Ashtaroth and at Edrei, and reigned in Mount Hermon, and in Salca, and in all Bashan, unto the border of the Geshurites and the Machthites, and half Gilead, the border of Sihon, king of Heshbon. Them did Moses, the servant of the Lord, and the children of Israel smite, and Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave it for a possession unto the Reubenites, and the Gadites, and the half tribe of Manasseh. Okay? So those are the two areas they're talking about. Remember, the children of Israel, in terms of conquering the land, these colored areas you see were the areas that were given to certain tribes. We're not going to go into that now. That's for people that are teaching later chapters, and we can talk about that. But that's what those colored areas mean. The children of Israel approached the promised land from about the Jericho level. You know, that's where they crossed the river. And Gilgal was their kind of their camp. Okay? Gilgal was the first place that they went after they crossed the river. And they kind of set up camp at Jericho. So those are the two areas first they're talking about. Now the next section we're going to read, these few verses, lists 31 kings west of the Jordan. I mean, it'll say on this side of Jordan, which indicates that the book of Joshua was written by either Joshua and or whomever was writing for him while they were in the promised land. They had conquered the land and they were inhabiting the land, because that's what it indicates. 31 kings in that area, which if you have a good Bible atlas, either online or print, you can see where these different areas are, but they're all over the place. A lot of times, biblically, what they'll do to describe an area is they'll kind of do the north and the south borders. They'll talk about Mount Hermon up here in the north, and then they'll say the River Arnon down here, which is here. So they're just using those two north and south points to describe the entire area. They do the same thing here. They'll talk about up by Lebanon, and they'll talk about down by Gaza. And these are some of the modern areas that we hear about in the news, too. You know, the Gaza Strip, that's right there. Gaza's right there. It was a Philistine city. You'll learn later if you read in Joshua, they didn't actually take that city. These were some of the lands. We'll learn later, certain portions of the promised land, they never actually conquered. They never actually kicked these people out. And we'll talk about that later. So, anyway, that's this area which we'll read right now. And we're just going to read through the list here. These are the kings, verse 7. And these are the kings of the country which Joshua and the children of Israel smote on this side of Jordan on the west, from Baal-Gad in the valley of Lebanon. That's up here. Okay? Lebanon's up there, so Baal-Gad in the valley of Lebanon. even unto the Mount Halak that goeth up to Seir. That's down in this area. Mount Halak is down here. Seir is right there in the area of Edom. So they're using Lebanon up here, and Seir down here to include that whole side of Israel. And this is modern Israel. This is it. So, let's keep reading. Which Joshua gave unto the tribes of Israel for possession according to their divisions, in the mountains and in the valleys and in the plains, the springs and in the wilderness and in the south country,
the Hittites, Amorites, Canaanites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And we're just going to read through the list. These are in chronological order, by the way, if you ever want to check it. They're listed the way that they were actually conquered. The king of Jericho, one. The king of Ai, which is beside Bethel, one. The king of Jerusalem, one. The king of Hebron, one. Jarmuth, one. Lachish, one. Eglon, one. Gezer, one. Deber, one. Gedor, one. Horma, one. Arad, one. Libna, one. Adullam, one. Makeda, one. Bethel, one. Tapua, one. Hefer, one. Aphek, one. Lashron, one. Medan, one. Hazor, one. Shimron, Miron, one. Aksaf, one. Tanakh, one. Megiddo, one. Kedesh, one. Jokneam of Carmel, one. Dor in the coast of Dor, one. The nations of Gilgal, one. And Tirzah, one. All the kings, 30 and 1. Now, so Joshua 12 is just a listing. This is what they did. Remember, it's a culmination of what starts happening in Joshua chapter 1 with the conquest of the land. The time frame for the actual conquest was about 7 years, right? So this is 7 years of war. Depending on your age, the Iraq War, I believe, was the longest war in United States history, I think. Is it not?
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't it 10 years?
Yep.
Okay. So, other wars, like the Civil War, was 4 years long. World War II, in which we lost 500,000 men, just the United States alone, more than 500,000 men killed. It was only from December of 41 through August of 45. So it was only 4 years. So this was a 7 year war. Remember, this was not war like we think of it. This was not you drive, you fly a drone from a joystick 500 miles away. This is not you shoot at somebody with a rifle. There was no such thing as that. You were standing toe to toe with somebody, and you were either going to kill them or they were going to kill you. Simple as that. For 7 years. That's what they did. The two kings on the far side, and one Moses is still alive, and then the 31 kings on the west side. So keep that in mind, that for 7 years they fight for this. Right? The promised land was, let's look at this, because it's important that you understand this, actually. Genesis chapter 12. I mentioned this before, but again, just so that you remember, the promised land as a promised land, Canaan as, I'm going to give you this land that God said to Abraham initially, is in Genesis chapter 12, verse 7. And it says, and the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, unto thy seed will I give this land. Let's back up one verse. And Abraham passed through the land unto the place of Sichem, unto the plain of Moreh, and the Canaanite was then in the land. So you know where he was. He was where the Canaanites lived. And then verse 7, and the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, unto thy seed will I give this land. And there builded he an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. Now the only reason I point that out is, that was about 500 years before all the events we read about in the book of Joshua. So the promise of the promised land was 500 years old by the time the book of Joshua starts. So, and the thing that I think about with this is the promises of God that you or I read about in God's Word take both time and they take effort. When God promised the promised land 500 years before, and then he finally, if you want to say this, delivers on the promise from the book of Joshua forward, not only did it take time, but he didn't, when he said, I give you the promised land, they had to go in and conquer two kings on the east and 31 kings on the west. It's not like he said, you know what, they'll all just leave, you just go ahead and go in and take possession. That didn't happen. So the promises of God in our lives, godliness in our lives, godly character, whatever you want to call it, the many things in life that are really worthwhile, take time and effort. And we see that in Joshua chapter 12. Because the promise was 500 years before the actual fulfillment starts. Right? And they had to fight for it. They had to do, like, think of the tribe of Reuben, the tribe of Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh that were on the east side of Jordan. know, they need their inheritance. This is what you guys got. Now we want you to leave your inheritance, go across the river, and fight for 7 years before you can go back to your inheritance. That's what they had to do. Right? So it wasn't easy. It was not an easy path. Some examples I've thought about, I guess, with this, biblical examples. You know, I don't know if you know chronologically the time period before, between what we call the Old Testament and what we call the New Testament. But it was 400 years. Now, I don't know why God chose to wait to bring Christ, to send Christ to her. I don't know. I don't know. But I know that the promise of the Messiah, most people acknowledge the first prophecy of the promise of the Messiah in Genesis chapter 3. That was like 4,000 years before he came. Right? Number one. Number two, the other chapter that I think of is Isaiah 53, the suffering Messiah. If you haven't read that, I encourage you to read it if you're not familiar with it. But there were still hundreds of years. Isaiah prophesies that like 700 BC. Right? There are still 700 years before Christ actually comes. I don't understand that, but I know that God's timing is right. In our lives as well. Other examples I thought of biblically are, you know, the coming of Christ I just talked about. The rise and expansion of the first century church. When Jesus comes to earth, ministers, is crucified, dies, is resurrected, ascends, leaves the 12, which is pretty much all they left. There wasn't really, as Pastor David has said many times, the way he tells the story, so to speak, I mean, the way he relates it is sort of like Jesus talking to the angels after Jesus ascends. He says, you know, what's the plan? Those 12 guys are there. And the angels are kind of looking, which, I mean, this is Albert. The angels are kind of looking, what's the plan B? There isn't a plan B. He left those 12 guys. And the next 30 years talk about the rise and expansion of the Christian church. Some really, really high points, some not so much. But it took time. Those 12 guys just kept plugging away, and others too. They just kept plugging away and they kept moving. Things I thought of in our everyday, I guess in my life, and perhaps in yours as well. Individual spiritual maturity. You ever think about how long it takes for a human being to become physically mature? What, 16, 17, 18 years? Mentally mature. Now just think about that in your own life. How long did that take you to become mentally mature? I mean, I will say for me, it took longer than 20 years, I'll tell you that. Okay. Yeah. Seriously. You know, there was a reason biblically that nobody listened to you before you were 30, because if you'll pardon the language, you didn't know your butt from the holy ground anyway. Really? I mean, you seriously didn't.
That's true.
Yeah. When not that I'm saying Jesus did that, I mean that, but one of the reasons in Luke it says, and Jesus began to be about 30 years of age. That's when he started his ministry. That was the quote-unquote accepted. I mean, it's like our 18 or 21. It was 30. Nobody's going to listen to you before that. Because you don't know what you're talking about. You don't have any life experience. You can't be mature. You can't. So it takes time. And you can't be impatient. You got to just keep putting one foot in front of the other and biblically doing what you're supposed to do to be a mature Christian, to be a mature man in Christ. Because that was always the goal. Look at Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians chapter 1, verse 27 or so. Yeah, 28. Colossians was written, Paul was in prison in Rome. The imprisonment that occurred at the end of the book of Acts. So he was in prison when he wrote this. Under house arrest, probably be a better way to describe that. But he was imprisoned for preaching Christ. So verse 28, Colossians chapter 1, verse 28. Whom Christ we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Do more modern translations say perfect? What does your translation say?
Perfect.
Does it say perfect? Any other ones? Really? So what it's the Greek word teleos, and it means mature. That's really what it means. It means mature. It means you can stand on your own two feet spiritually. So that was the goal The goal was every man mature in Christ. Now, that takes time and it takes patience. Just like the Joshua 12 thing. I mean, they were walking toward this promise for hundreds of years and then fighting for this promise for 7 years in the promised land. It takes time. You can't stop. Another thing I thought of was building a marriage. My wife and I have been, this year, July 26th, next month, have been married 37 years. Right? So you never get away from executing the basics of a marital relationship. Let me repeat that. You never get away from executing the basics of a marital relationship. Did you hear what I said? Really? Because I don't care if you're married 50 years, you never get away from executing the basics of a marital relationship. You always have to do those things. You always have to. It just takes time and patience. You gotta do it. So that was another thing. And the other thing I thought about was raising kids. Again, if you have a child, you volunteer for 20 years because that's how long it's gonna take you. Right? That's how long it's gonna take you to bring them from changing their poopy diaper to, hopefully, if they make their own decisions as you teach them, mature individual and hopefully mature in Christ. That's how long it's going to take. It's going to take 20 years, right? And as I think I've talked about this before, but I don't remember the context, you're never not their father. If you have children, or if you're going to have children, you are never not their father. You are never not their father. Which means you are always responsible to be an example of godliness to them and to teach them the Bible to the best of your ability within the context of your influence at that stage in their life. You are always responsible to do that. That never goes away. So that was another thing I thought of with time and effort. I mean, you just got to keep doing this stuff. Just like we read a synopsis of everything in Joshua 12 of this is what happened, but so much went before that. So much went before that. The promise itself being 5 centuries old, before you even get there. And then the last thing, example I thought was building a church. Right? I think the marriage, the marriage is probably the greatest example of the need for time and consistent execution. Raising kids, probably number 2. Building a church, probably number 3. Because we just got to keep doing it. Sometimes, and if you read the book of Acts, it was like that. You got a day of Pentecost when 3,000 are saved. And then you got Paul in 2 Timothy chapter 4 saying, or 2 Timothy chapter 1 saying, everybody in Asia has turned away from you. You got the high points, and you got the low points. You got in Ephesus, they start a bonfire and burn books of curious arts that are worth 50,000 pieces of silver. And then you got Luke is the only one with Paul at the end of his life. There's nobody else. Everybody else left. So you got high points and low points. What do? You keep ministering. You do what 2 Timothy, turn to 2 Timothy chapter 4. The books of 1 and 2 Timothy for me are some of my favorite books of the Bible. I trust you have a favorite book, but Deuteronomy, 1 and 2 Timothy are some of my favorite books of the Bible. So, 2 Timothy chapter 4, Paul was in prison when he wrote this as well. He was in an imprisonment. It was an imprisonment that is not recorded in the book of Acts. It is not recorded at all. It was the imprisonment when he was martyred. He was killed. So these are his, the reason I mention that is these are his closing remarks. These are the last things Timothy is going to hear from him. There will be no more communication of that. Paul knows it. He says it. Right? He says in chapter 4, verse 6. For now I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. He knew the time was short. He was in prison. He knew it wasn't going to be long. Okay? So these are his closing remarks. So what does he tell Timothy about how to conduct a church? Verse 1. Chapter 4, 2 Timothy. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead, and his appearing in his kingdom, Preach the word. Be instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Right? So the last things he tells him are preach the word. And the be instant, in season, out of season, as it's not really a sidelight, it's Paul's emphasis on how much you need to preach the word. You may remember from Pastor David Sherry or one of the other pastors possibly about the Greek word for, there are several Greek words for time. Okay? And one of them is the word kairos. And the word kairos means opportune time. So this be instant in season, out of season, when it says in season, it means when there is an opportune time. When it says out of season, it means when there isn't an opportune time. In other words, even if you don't have a good opportunity, you still preach the word. Whether you have the opportunity or you don't, you preach the word. That's the main thing. That's what you got to do. So building a church, you just got to keep going, man. You just got to keep putting one foot in front of the other. You just got to keep doing it. So anyway, that's when I looked at chapter 12, I thought, what a great testimony to the realization of a promise of God that was centuries in coming and years in the actual fight. Let's see. I only want to review this very briefly. I went over this when we talked about Joshua chapter 10. And in Joshua chapter 10, as you may remember from Deuteronomy 7, look at Deuteronomy chapter 7. Genesis, Exodus, Deuteronomy. We're going to talk very briefly about the people who inhabited the land of Canaan and whether when God said you kill everything that breathes, whether it was a judgment, whether it was truly annihilation was the goal here, or if he just wanted to kick them out of the land. Okay. And that comes into play later because of some of the things that the children of Israel don't do, that they don't follow God's word.
Deuteronomy chapter 12, so I'm not going to say. Chapter 7, verse 2. Who has ever got that? Deuteronomy 7, 2.
And when the Lord your God delivers the power to you, you shall conquer him and utterly destroy him. You shall make no covenant with the Lord your mercy.
Okay, and then we looked at this in the context of Joshua chapter 10. Turn there, please, Joshua chapter 10, and we'll read verse 40.
Joshua chapter 10, verse 40. So anybody who's got that, if you would read that, please.
So Joshua conquered all the land, the mountain country in the south, and the lowland, and the wilderness slopes, and all their kings. He left none remaining, but utterly destroyed all that breathed, as the Lord God of Israel had commanded.
Now, we read the command in Deuteronomy, and that isn't the only place it appears. Well, we read it there, and we read that Joshua actually did that. To those lands he conquered, he killed everybody. Okay, so let's look at a couple of details just by way of reminder. Among Bible students, there are two possible approaches to understanding the fact that God said kill everything. One was, he didn't really mean that, he was exaggerating. He just meant, get them out of the land, including their idolatry, get them out of the land. The other camp, so to speak, of Bible students is annihilated. It was a judgment because of what they did, because of their behavior. Okay, now, I personally, having looked at the biblical text myself, I mean, you just read it, and I'm not a scholar on this stuff, I'm simply reading the same Bible you guys are, right? And trying to look a little deeper, trying to look beyond just reading it one or two times. I come down on the side of this was judgment. God intended for them to be wiped out. That's why he said it the way he said it in Deuteronomy chapter 7. He wanted the Canaanites entirely gone, dead, everybody. Right? That was what he wanted. It was a judgment. Now, I'll tell you why I think that. First of all, the face value of the words we just read in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 2 is kill it. Right? I mean, that's, if you just read the words, that's what they appear to say. There doesn't seem to be any ambiguity there to me. You don't need a dictionary to understand any of those words. Perfect to understand them. So, I don't know if we're going to do all this stuff. Let's just remind ourselves of the Canaanite religion,
okay,
of the idolatry that they actually practiced. This is what was going on in Canaan, the promised land, at the time that the Israelites were told to go in and take it. Okay? This is what was happening. Their religion called for things like divination, and fortune-telling, like we have now, witchcraft. What do you know? We have that now, too. Female or male temple prostitutes. I'm not aware of any churches, at least in Kernersville, that do that. However, they did in Corinth, for example. You know, the Greek religion did that. Adultery, that was part of their religion. Homosexuality, part of their religion. Transvestitism, part of their religion. Pederasty, if you don't know what pederasty is, that's a man with a boy. Okay, that's what that is. That was all part of their religion. And it gets worse or better depending on your point of view. Now, just pointing out, we have all those things except for maybe the temple prostitute part in this country going on now. Now, God judged them for that. You got to think about what that means for the United States as a country, because we're doing all the same things. Right? Except for the female and male temple prostitutes. Everything up there is happening in the United States commonly.
Vegas.
Even in this area. What's that?
Vegas.
Yeah, that might be. So, bestiality. Okay? And a bestiality is a human with an animal. Sexual. That's what bestiality is, human with an animal. There are laws in Leviticus specifically prohibiting bestiality. So it was a common practice. Otherwise, God wouldn't have said, don't do it. Somebody must have been doing it, or he wouldn't have had to say, don't do it. Right? So it wasn't foreign to the Israelites, because the Israelites are the ones who got the law in the first place. And then incest, that was common. Other things about the Canaanite religion, child sacrifice was common. Infants to children as old as 4 years old. Archaeology indicates the kids that they sacrificed were up to 4 years old. You think about your son, daughter, grandson, granddaughter, that's that old. You just think about that. The method of sacrifice was burning. They burnt them. So they'd have an idol, statue of an idol, and they'd have a fire pit right there, and the idol statue would be constructed such that the idol had hands cupped like that. That was part of the statue. They put the kid in the hands. The fire was under the hands. They would put the kid in there until he or she burnt to death. That's how they sacrificed. Okay? And this, again, you can look at, you can do a web search on this and read about it all day on the internet. This is not rocket science here. This is, I mean, everybody knows this. This is what was going on. And children sacrificed sometimes numbered in the thousands. We're not talking about one or two kids here. This was Canaanite religion. This was what was going on in the land of Canaan. Now, what's interesting about this to me is you think about, okay, how long were they engaged in that? Do you remember the record of Sodom and Gomorrah? Who remembers that? If you haven't read that record, I encourage you to read it. It's of Genesis 19, I believe. Sodom and Gomorrah were Canaanite cities. They were right down on the southern border of the Dead Sea, part of the land that the children of Israel first conquered in the Promised Land. Right? And what did he do to Sodom and Gomorrah? What did God do to them, do you recall? Destroyed them completely. Before he destroyed, Lot was living there. Lot was Abraham's cousin. Lot was living there, so there was an episode where some angels come to visit Lot to get him out of the city before they're going to destroy him. Right? So the Sodomites, which if you don't know what sodomy is prohibited by law in this country until recently, and it's a form of intercourse between a man and a man. Okay? So the Sodomites come to the door, and they want to take, and you can read this record, they want to take the guests. And it says, we want to take them that we might know them. Now, what that means biblically is that they wanted to sexually assault them. So that was going on in Sodom and Gomorrah 500 years before the Promised Land. So how long were they engaged in that sort of stuff? Roughly 5 centuries. Something like that. That's how long it was going on. Did they have an opportunity to believe? Again, God judges them. God says, kill everybody. right? Did they have an opportunity to believe? You remember the record that we read about Rahab, okay? When Rahab talks to the two spies, she says, "We know what God did for you. We know how you parted the Red Sea." Okay, so when she relates that story, it's the beginning of Joshua, the parting of the Red Sea happened 40 years before that. So those miracles, the mighty things that God did, were well known. At least in Jericho, they were well known. I'm guessing they were well known through the whole country. And, if you don't remember that record, again, I encourage you to read it. You remember what Rahab did? She believed, right? She was saved. So was her family. She becomes part of the Christ line. Could they have believed? That worked for Rahab. No reason it couldn't work for everybody else, right? So the crux of the problem, I don't think we need to go over that. I'll just mention that when we read a record like Joshua and he kills everybody, if we have trouble with that, it may be because we don't have enough trouble with sin. We don't dislike it enough. That is to say, we get to the point that we are willing to peacefully coexist with it. Like, frankly, many Christians are in this country. And I'm not pointing the finger there, I'm not including myself. I mean, there is that tendency among Christians. It's okay, it's just...
So, I'm going to go back to one thing.
Yeah, this was a quote by a fellow who wrote a book about this, about the fact that the conquering of the promised land was actually judgment. No. And he says, in a certain sense, the lesson of the conquest is a simple one. God punishes evil. For many in our culture, though, when we're talking about the United States, the Canaanite offenses simply are not offensive. Divination, sexual adventure, adultery, homosexuality, transvestitism, all evil? Please. And you can read the newspaper and read about all those things. Now, that's both at, I guess at one time it's scary, and it's a call to arms for Christians because the only answer here is Christ. There isn't another answer. There is no other answer but Christ, both for you individually and for our country. There isn't another answer. So, anyway, let's go on. So, relative to the whole sin thing with judgment, if we have a tendency to think, no, why did he kill everybody? Wasn't that a little severe? Wasn't that a little over? There's a, go to 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I covered this at the end of, I think, the Joshua chapter 10 chapter, but I sort of covered it kind of fleetingly because I was a little over on time, but in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, there's a great verse. We'll read verse 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. Now the word seared, again, gives a little more graphic picture, is the Greek word kauteriazo, to cauterize. And I related at the time that I first shared this that I'm a physical therapist, so part of my training was to go in and observe surgeries. Okay? So I observe a lady that's having a total knee replacement. So you're standing around the operating table and you're watching what they do, everything they do. Okay? So they got to get the blood out of the leg. So they put it up in the air, they drain all the blood that way, and they kind of massage it down, and then they put a tourniquet on it to keep the blood out, right? And then they do their incision and all that stuff. So while during the surgery, they also have to stem blood flow as much as they can. They want to minimize blood loss. So for the little blood vessels, they take a hot poker, and they cauterize it. You can hear the flesh burn a little bit when they do. That's cauterizing. have their conscience seared, well, they have their conscience cauterized. In other words, they're exposed to the evil enough that their conscience is burned enough that it no longer affects them. They hear about homosexuality enough that, you know, it must be okay because it's in the papers, everybody's doing this, I mean, it's all over Hollywood, it's in the movies, it must be okay. Seared. Conscience is seared. We always, for our only rule of faith and practice is God's word. It is our rule of faith and practice. If it is not true in here, then it is not true. I don't care what the culture says. It doesn't make any difference. What is in here is true. If it's not in here, then you got no basis for it. It's as simple as that. That's part of making Jesus Christ not only your Savior, he gets you out of hell, if you want to call it that, but making him your Lord. He calls the shots. If it's not in there, then it's not true. So, when we look at something like Joshua, and we have trouble with the fact that God did what he did in judgment for people that had been doing all kinds of sexual weird stuff and sacrificing kids for 5 centuries. So, I don't have a problem with judging that. And I better not have a problem with judging that because God said it. I mean, that settles it right there. It's all there's to it. But if we do, we have to ask ourselves a question. Have we been
backfights?
Yeah.
Nevertheless, the children of Israel did not drive out the Gershites or the Mashites, but the Gershites and the Mashites dwell among the Israelites until this day.
Good. Okay, who's got 1563? Anybody?
Yeah, yeah.
Go.
As for the Jebusites, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the children of Judah, cannot drive them out, but the Jebusites dwell with the children of Judah at Jerusalem to this day.
Okay. Who's anybody got 16:10?
Then Delilah said to Samson,
Whoa. Joshua 16:10. How do we get to Samson and Delilah?
I can do it.
16:10. Yeah, you can do the next one. Go ahead, 16:10.
All right, and they did not drive out the Canaanites who dwelt in Gezer, but the Canaanites dwell among the Ephraimites to this day and have become forced laborers.
Okay. Anybody got Joe? You want to do 17:12-13, or are we
going? 17:12. Yeah. Yet the children of Manasseh did not drive out the inhabitants of those cities, but the Canaanites were determined to dwell in that land. And it happened when the children of Israel grew strong that they put the Canaanites to forced labor, but did not utterly drive them out.
Okay. And 23, we've got 23:12-13. Anybody? Go ahead.
But the descendants of Manasseh were unable to occupy these towns. They could not drive out the Canaanites who continued to live there. Later on, however, when the Israelites became strong enough, they forced the Canaanites to work as slaves, but they did not drive them out of the land.
Okay. And then everybody, if you would, turn to Psalm 6. And we'll start in verse 34. So this is Psalm 106, kind of it recounts the history of the children of Israel. So this portion is about what happens in the promised land. Psalm 106, verse 34. They did not destroy the nations concerning whom the Lord commanded them, but were mingled among the heathen and learned their works, and they served their idols, which were a snare unto them. Yea, they sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils, and shed innocent blood, even the blood of their own sons and of their daughters, whom they sacrificed unto the idols of Canaan, and the land was polluted with blood. Now, the only reason I point that out is, you can see why God said, destroy everything. Because if they didn't do that, Psalm 106, verses 34 to 36 is what happens. They assimilated. And when you read the rest of the book of Joshua, when we look at Joshua 24, you can see assimilation was at the end of Joshua's life. Assimilation was already started. If you read the book of Judges, you can see the obedience-disobedience cycle. It's the assimilation of the children of Israel from the fact that they never knew about the Canaanites in the first place. And that's what all those verses talk about. They never drove them out in the first place. They never, we read it, they sacrificed their own sons and their own daughters to their, to those Canaanite gods. They assimilated fully to what the Canaanites were doing. And that was the reason God said wipe them out in the first place. Because Israel was supposed to be a nation of priests. It was supposed to be the go-between between God and the nations. That's what Israel was supposed to be. But they never got there because they simply wouldn't do it. There weren't enough Joshuas. Joshua did it for what he took care of, but there simply weren't enough Joshuas. So you gotta ask yourself, are you a Joshua or not? And I think my question, and I ask myself this question too, am I willing to peacefully coexist with the devil? Now for us, this isn't a matter of like warfare, you're gonna go in and kill somebody because of promised land. It's not that. It's when you wake up in the morning and something goes wrong, are you going to react with a Christian maturity, or are you going to fly off the handle and be angry and do something stupid? The battles are different, but they're still battles. So are we willing to peacefully coexist with, I'll practice this part of Christianity, but I'm not so sure about that. I don't think I want to give that up yet. Are we willing to peacefully coexist with a little bit of Christianity and a little bit not? Or are we really going to try to build Christian maturity throughout our lives? Are we really going to do that? Let's look at 1 Peter 5:8. Yeah, let's look at 1 Peter 5:8. We'll close with these two scriptures. 1 Peter 5:8. In fact, I think we'll close with 1 Peter 5:8. Because it's all over the place, for heaven's sake. I mean, if you believe in God, you've got to believe in the devil. He gets a lot of print, okay? Jesus Christ faces him face to face in the wilderness. He gets a lot of print in there. So you've got to understand that there is an adversary, and you can't peacefully coexist with your adversary. You can't do that. That's not possible. You can't do that. We can't do that as Christians, as men, mature men in Christ. You can't do that. You can't coexist with the devil. That's not possible. You think it is, it's not. So, that's Joshua 12, and I'll close with prayer. If you have any questions or comments.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the time we've had to study your word, for your goodness to us, for even giving us your word. Thank you for teaching us as only you can. What we need to learn. In Christ and to become more mature in Christ. Thank you for these things. Again, thank you for these men and the time they take to be here. In Jesus Christ. Amen. Any comments or questions?
Yeah. So I just wanted to ask you to that reference you used in 1 Timothy 4 about the sound doctrine, enduring sound doctrine. I guess what I understood it to say when you read it, was that and about the transition of the ups and downs of the church, basically being ready to share the gospel or preach the gospel or be in ministry, no matter what, if there's an opportunity or if there is not an opportunity, but still know and be recognized that the people that you're preaching to probably don't want to endure the truth. Kind of like that. That's what I kind of heard you say. You know, so, and again, to me, that's kind of like, you know, that's the battle. But you know nobody's listening at this point. You know.
It's the battle sometimes, yeah. Well, I'll just speak from my own experience. It's the battle sometimes you have to fight with yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't want to listen.
Mm-hmm. Okay?
It's the battle you may fight with your wife, because she may not want to listen, even though you might be right on God's word. It's the battle you fight with your kids, because I will guarantee you, they don't want to listen. It's the battle you may fight with the church, because that's the... by the time 2 Timothy rolls around...
Nobody here wants to listen.
Yeah, that's true. But you continue to preach no matter what. Yeah, you know, Hebrews 4:12 is such a great verse. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. It's quick, it's powerful. There is no substitute. That's it. You got it. That's a great point that you brought up. People don't want to listen. I don't want to listen. But I got to keep preaching the word to myself, to my wife, to my family, to anybody I have contact with in church. I mean, really when you think about it, you know, you preach the gospel if you never open your mouth. Now, the question is it a good preaching? But you preach the gospel if you never open your mouth. You preach the gospel by the way you look at somebody, by whether you smile or not, by you open the door for them or you don't. I mean, you're preaching the gospel or you're not. One of the two, you are, even if you don't open your mouth. But that's a great point. A lot of times, people don't want to listen. A lot of times, I don't want to listen. I mean, how many times has God tried to speak to you or to me, and we won't hear it? How did that happen?
Pretty much everybody was killed except for John, because nobody wanted to listen to him.
Yeah. He's the only one that died. Traditionally died a natural death.
He was first.
Was that not,
what was that scripture reference again?
Which one?
2 Timothy 3.
Oh, 1 Timothy 4. No, I'm sorry. 2 Timothy 4. 2? 2? Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. That way. 2 Timothy 4. 2. Any other comments or questions?
I use that verse. I mean, we talk about evangelism circles. We talked about evangelism in the past, and you know, it's one that's difficult, but it's you know, it's like, you know, some people would say, you know, well, I don't know if it's the right time to share. You know, I'm always thinking of this verse. You know, it's like,
how do you tell that? Seriously, how do you tell that?
Yeah.
I agree though. I mean, I thought the same thing. Well, I don't know. They look like they got it together. I don't know if they really need to hear about Jesus. Yes. Okay, that works. That makes a lot of sense.
Then you back yourself into a corner.
Exactly.
And you start,
that's exactly.
Like what you're saying, then you kind of just start, you're kind of living with the sin at that point. You kind of make,
correct,
going along with it and not,
right,
going against the grain.
Peacefully coexisting.
Peacefully coexisting. We're in sin.
Right. That's exactly right.
Yeah.
It can happen. It's very insidious. It's you don't realize it.
Right.
I mean, I know that's happened to me. You just don't realize it. Which is why we just got to keep building God's word in your mind. I mean, as Christian men striving for maturity, you know, we're responsible to lead ourselves. We're responsible to lead our wives. We're responsible to lead our children. Those responsibilities don't go away. Nobody else has got those responsibilities. God didn't say to Pastor Nick to renew my mind. He said, Steve, you got to be transformed. Right? It isn't his job to renew my mind. It's mine. It's yours. It's your job. You know, again, when you think of what God did in Egypt and the plagues and bringing people out, etc., etc., Isn't it amazing that he comes to Moses in the wilderness in Exodus 3 and 4 and he says, you go and bring the people out. And then he says to Joshua, you go and take the promised land. He has decided to need men. Otherwise he wouldn't. But he decided to need us. I mean, he's the God of the universe. My son put this morning, he watches nature shows sometimes. He said, Dad, he said, I read about this, there were two big whales. One was a sperm whale, one was a blue whale. So the blue whale is the largest living creature that we know of that has ever lived. It gets to be 100 feet long and 100,000 pounds. That's how big a blue whale is. Right. Now, that's just one creature that God spoke into existence in a day. He just said, let the earth bring forth, and it's there. By the way, this is a little bit of a stream of consciousness, but I encourage you to watch on Netflix a movie called Is Genesis History? Yes. I really encourage you to watch that.
That's new.
It's good.
Yes. It's really, they do a great job. They do a great job. Is Genesis history? They do a great job. So we're dealing with God, the God that spoke into being everything that you see in 6 days. Does he need us? Of course he doesn't need us. But he decided to need us, right? He decided, he said, okay, you lead your family. I'm not going to do it for you. You lead your family. You lead yourself. You lead your wife. I'm not going to do it for you. I'll help you, but I'm not going to do it for you. So it's just a great thing to realize. That the choices you make and the privilege that God has given you to make the choices we make, it's just, we are so unbelievably blessed to be able to live in this country and choose to live as a Christian. That's just incredible.
I mentioned at the beginning as you're teaching something that reminded me of a question that somebody asked me Sunday morning that I didn't get back to them about. It was the intertestamental period,
right.
The time between Malachi and Matthew,
right.
400 years. Why did God wait so long was the question. And I'm pretty darn sure that there wasn't anywhere in Scripture you're going to find an answer. I alluded to that, but I said I'd look into it, but I don't have an answer.
Yeah.
No, if there is one.
The only answer I've got, I've got the reference.
Thursday night.
If it's in Galatians, I don't remember the reference, but it says, when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law. It was the fullness of time. From God's perspective, we're not going to know what that is until maybe Christ returns.
It was kind of those prerequisites to Daniel's prophecies. It was 69
Oh, the
weeks.
69 weeks.
Well, 69, we're in the crosshairs of what actually the Bible does speak of. I'm sorry, I didn't know what to teach person. But you know, that Daniel chapter 11, I mean, he goes through the time period in which Rome ends up becoming a power again, and it's just shortly thereafter that the New Testament picks up again. So there is prophecies predicting specifically. We went through the first 21 verses in Daniel 11, went through all the different the Greek, the Seleucids and Ptolemies, the different kings from the time period of Daniel, even some of the prophets during that time period wrote more so during the Persian conquest. But anyway, it's prophesied specifically. But you know, I mean, during that time period, you're talking about the establishment of, you know, Greek language, Koinonia,
right. Being
the writing of the New Testament. It was, you know, during that empire, Alexander's empire, the four generals, and the kings that followed that substantiated that language for it to be worldwide. And then Rome, you know, obviously they came into and they started making the Roman roads, you know, 100 plus years before Christ.
It's
they established it. I mean, I've been to Turkey, I've been to Israel, and then they're still there. I mean, you know, talking about the roads, for one of the first road systems, really. So it's kind of unique in that scripture that Steve referenced there in Galatians, how the Lord really did systematically build everything up for the gospel to really just, you know, in a lot of ways hit the ground running. You know.
So come Thursday night.
We
lead into this. I'm Greek, from the Greeks to the Romans. But it is the only really thing I can think of during the intertestamental period, I mean, other than those prophecies in Daniel, which the Daniel 9 and the Daniel 11 ties into Daniel 9 because it's part of that 69 periods of 7 years that's coming into play, because that's when Messiah would come and he'd be cut off, and then that's where it's cut out of time. Paul's button on history and all that stuff as it relates to the Jews, to that 70 weeks, 70 periods, 70 years.
77.
Yeah, 77s and stuff. So, and it's really fascinating just thinking it through. That's about the only section of scripture I can think of with the intertestamental period.
That's correct.
That actually alludes to that period. It's from Daniel 11, because it takes into that account what's going on. It's very specific. Extremely specific.
That's outstanding. Okay, any questions or concerns?
No, thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to share those. Have a great evening. Thanks for coming. Appreciate it, guys.